American government is. It's sad. And would you please join me for 1 second? Let's do the Pledge of Allegiance. Would you please stand?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Still standing, my friend. That's a beautiful thing. Please don't take that for granted. A lot of people died for that. A lot of people suffered for that. A lot of people still suffer for that every day. Their families, their kids, their children, the kids who don't have a dad, don't have a mom, or the dad hops or limps, it suffers every day because of that flag and allowing that flag to fly. Well, moving on to a good and positive thing. These are collector's items. One day you'll say, I had an opportunity to win one of these. Everybody will be jealous, but only a few, the chosen few, will have one. Ask me about the Dawson County Tea Party. It says, have you had enough yet? Have you had enough yet? Are you fed up yet? Are you mad yet?
Yes.
Are you doing anything about it yet? That's what it's all about. You know, talk's cheap.
We're here.
That's right. Let's do something about it. Have you had enough yet? Well, here's your opportunity. And all you had to do was show up. Stick your hand out. Be lucky. The one on the end of this ticket here. Let's see. Or all the numbers sure to get smaller as time goes on. What is it? Is it 881? That would be you, young lady. Oh boy. Oh boy. You can change it in from whatever size you want, as long as this one just like that one.
Thank you. Perfect.
You're sure welcome. Thank you
so much.
Hey, you're sure welcome.
We need some of this down in Brookhaven.
There you go. There you go. Well, does anybody have anything they'd like to share with this fine group? Yes, sir. Hank.
Just let everybody know that next Thursday is our meeting at Lanier Tea Party Patriots, and Mary Kate Bacayao is going to be there, and she's going to be talking about legislation that's coming up in the General Assembly this year pertaining to cementing Common Core into place. And if we don't get behind an effort to defeat this legislation, then it will be there. So she's in the know. She's going to be there next Thursday night. I hope you'll come if you can. It's at the Gainesville Civic Center at 7 o'clock next Thursday. Okay, thank you.
And next Tuesday, Mary Jane was passing out, you are all invited to our wonderful Congressman Doug Collins' annual Christmas party at Babyland General. Just bring a toy. Come, dinner will be provided. He would love to see you all. Bill Coakley sends his regrets. He had a conflict and was not able to attend tonight. Also, there is the schedule. It's convention time for the Republican Party, which means we have our convention. We make resolutions and elect our leaders, so to speak, our elected officials, not our leaders. But anyway, it's the whole process. The dates are here, and I'm excited to say that the 9th District Convention, thanks to Vernon and Jessica Gaines, will be here at the Lakeview Center.
Yay.
We were honored to be, they were so impressed. And the final note is, anybody, you're concerned over immigration and the president's executive order, reminder, please call Doug Collins' office and express your concerns. I don't know if y'all would send an email out with his email address and his cell phone number reminding everyone to do that in the next couple of days. That would be great.
Sure. Okay. I have one announcement I'd like to make, if I could. And
This young lady has a pamphlet, and it's Nydia, it's free, I understand. And she's taking donations. If you'd like to contribute to her cause, they're free. If you don't want to contribute, that's fine too. But if you'd like to, she has a little table in the back with little books on the back. And my understanding is Georgia Sunshine Laws. This is a citizen's guide to open government. There you go. There you go. And, we appreciate her filming. That being said, anyone else has any announcements? If not, I'd like to turn the podium over to my best buddy, Dale Smart.
This is going to be just a quick announcement. We are starting to line up our programs for January, February, March, and April. Hank is going to come and talk to us on a new presentation he's done on the meaning of America, and I'm really excited about seeing that. And we're not quite sure which date, but that's for sure sometime in the next 4 months. We've been talking to Alex Johnson, who is ran for the Georgia Republican chairmanship, and he's put together a presentation about uniting the party, or uniting our efforts. So we're talking to him, and Al Newman hopefully will be coming to talk to us. He's a constitutional lawyer, or he teaches constitutional law. He's done different presentations all around the state, and we hope to have him in January. Hank is up here to help me introduce our speaker, but come on up, Derrick. Hank knows a lot about Derrick, but he did know some very important information, so we decided we were going to do this like an interview. Where were you born?
I was born in Mobile, Alabama.
And how long have you been in Atlanta?
6 months from the date of my birth.
Right.
Yes, mother, father, brother, sister, daughters, and a whole host of cousins and whatnot.
Okay, and what are you going to do after you're in the Senate? Are you going to leave MARTA?
I'll leave MARTA, and I'm hoping that Georgia voters will help me change and restore this country.
Good for you. Hey, you got the word. You don't want to.
Dale, all I wanted to say was that I met Derrick November 22nd, 2013, which was the 50th anniversary of the assassination of John F. Kennedy, and I met him down at the Federal Reserve Building in downtown Atlanta, midtown Atlanta. And we were at an Abolish the Fed meeting down there. And what I think is always funny is that I remember people like Derrick, but when later I meet them again, they don't remember me. So he didn't remember me, but I want to recount one thing that he said, because he got up and spoke to the group there. And he talked about the restoring of America, and with respect to the occasion being the anniversary of John F. Kennedy's death. And I don't mean to bring you down, but I do want to kind of cement the discussion a little bit. He said to be able to restore the country, anyone who really hopes to be able to do that has got to be willing to die for it. And that just stuck in my head. How many of our elected officials are really willing to die for the principles of freedom and the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution? I venture to say, probably not that many. But one of the things that has really come home to me in watching Derrick go through his candidacy this past year for the U.S. Senate seat was that he is willing to die to bring this country back. And if you had listened to any of the Senate debates, you would have known that every one of them was won by this guy. None of the other Senate candidates even held a candle in front of him. But the press would not let that information out. So unless you were there or you watched it in some way, form, or fashion, you wouldn't have known. But Derrick actually shut every one of the other Senate candidates down. And
So with that, I just want to turn it over to Derrick Grayson, introduce you to Derrick Grayson.
I want everybody in here to give yourself a hand clap of praise. And I'm going to tell you why. You showed up. You care. Most voters only care about what they're going to get out of the deal. And that's part of the problem with this country. And I'll talk about some of the other things. There are a lot of things that I can talk about, but before I talk about some of those, a lot of things, I want to thank Linda, Vernon, Dale. Linda treated us to a wonderful dinner. Thank you very much. And Dale and Vernon for inviting Team Grayson up here. I'm happy to see Catherine here. She's a true trooper. And all of you, Ms. Tisdale over here to the right, that's a very brave woman. And I want to touch a little bit on that. So without further ado, let me go ahead and jump into this. There are four primary things that I want to talk about briefly. I want to try not to talk too long because I got an email about some things that, some possible questions that you may have, and to keep you from being here too long, I want to leave some time to answer your questions. I used to say in the beginning, ask me anything you want to know, just make sure you really want to know. Because sometimes the truth will hurt you. And when you tell people the truth, many of them can't handle it. And so I'm going to be sharing some truths with you tonight. And everything that I say is verifiable, is documented, most of it on government letterhead. All you got to do is go and look it up. I call it low-hanging fruit. So I don't spend my time on conspiracy theories, talking about chemtrails and fluoride in the water, because there is so much other stuff. I mean, the fruit is so low, it's laying on the ground. So those are the things that we're going to talk about tonight. Before I get into the meat, I want to talk about what we've been seeing lately in the news. Police militarization, police brutality, Ferguson, and a gentleman by the name of David Hooks. Make no mistake about it, the government is militarizing our police forces. If you don't believe me, ask yourself, why would they give police forces, local police, bayonets? That's verifiable, it's documented on government letterhead. Tanks, flashbang grenades, all of that is happening. Now, for the record, most cops are good cops, and they do a good job. But I also recognize that they follow orders, just like our soldiers do. And I support the troops. I was one of the few candidates that had the troops back when I was running. They're in places they have no business being, and everybody wants to be mad with the troops. But they don't want to be mad with themselves for voting for the politicians that sent the troops to the war in the first place. To me, that don't make sense. Everybody wants to be mad at the police wholesale, but they don't want to accept responsibility for the people that they elect who make the policies and legislation that the police officers follow. Now, do we have bad cops? Yes. Do we have bad soldiers in the military? Yes. But that is not the vast majority of them. But the people we need to be looking at are the ones at the top. Police brutality. People send me a ton of videos to look at. And in 99.9% of them, the individual is resisting arrest. Now, do some police officers go too far with the beat down? With killing unarmed people? Yes, they do. Which is why I advise people when I talk to them. As long as due process is alive, don't resist. Live by complying, going to jail, and getting yourself a lawyer, even if it's a public defender. It's not worth dying on the streets because you think you are being mistreated by a police officer or that he should not take you to the jail. The only thing it's going to get you is killed. Now, CBM, corporate backed media, is a tool of both parties, the royals, and I always distinguish that so that folk know I'm not talking about rank and file. And that tool is used to divide. They have put out this narrative of division that black men are an endangered species, that they are being hunted down by police officers on a whole scale basis. And it is absolutely not true. Over the last decade, approximately 1,500 black men have been killed by police officers. But over 2,300 white men have been killed by police officers. So, where is the disparity there? The disparity is more white men have been killed by police officers than black men. So then, why are we being told that police are hunting down black men? Because it creates division. They want blacks mad with the police. They want whites mad with blacks. Blacks are saying we're still being mistreated. Whites are saying you ought to take responsibility for your own actions. But what's not being repeated, what's not being reported by the press, is the same thing that's happening to white folks. Now, I'm going to say something that might offend some of you, but you need to recognize this. White privilege is dead in America. I'm going to say it again. White privilege is dead in America. You just don't hear about it in the news. The largest single group in this country that has the ability to turn around what's been happening in this country is middle class white America. So the narrative cannot be those things that will wake them up. The narrative has to be the things that will keep them sleeping. And in this grand illusion that it cannot happen to them, that it is not happening to them. Well, let me give you a little reality. Jobs. More black people aren't being made poor in America. More middle class white people are being made poor. More black people aren't going on welfare or food stamps in America. More white people are now going on food stamps and welfare in America. You want to know why? Because government is killing the jobs that used to be here in America. You call Cisco's technical support, you get somebody over in India. You call Bank of America, customer service, you get somebody over in India. You call Priceline.com, you get somebody down in Mexico. Those used to be American jobs. Well, why in the devil aren't those jobs here? I'll tell you why. Because government engaged in what we call these trade agreements. These trade agreements created an imbalance that allowed corporations to make even more profits by moving and offshoring jobs and manufacturing overseas that started to kill, and that started killing jobs here in America. That is why unemployment amongst whites is now higher than it has ever been in the history of this country since the Great Depression. But that is because of things that are being done in DC. Now here's something that's real funny. David Perdue said, yes, I supported outsourcing, that's what I did. And I'm proud of it, but it's the politicians that forced me to have to do that. While at the same time, he voted for some of those same politicians that enacted or passed the legislation that allowed for these unfair trade agreements in the first place. You can't have it both ways, David Perdue. You're either a part of the problem or you're going to be a part of the solution. And he's been a part of the problem all along. Now I'm going to say something that might hurt a few feelings, but you're going to have to just work with me on this one. During the course of 7 debates and 3 additional televised debates, I challenged all seven of my opponents to say one sentence. I will obey 100% of the Constitution, 100% of the time. And in any of the debates, none of them uttered those words. They refused my challenge at each and every debate. And in the last debate, I said, I made a challenge, no one accepted it. Therefore, if I don't make it out of the primary, I won't be voting for any of them. I will vote myself in first, write myself in first, because I will not be complicit any longer in voting for people who will not honor the Constitution. And it is the dishonoring of the Constitution that is why we are in the shape that we are in this country today. And at every debate, and I'm going to do it here, raise your hands if you love the Constitution. Okay? Now put your hands down. How much of the Constitution are you willing to give up? Raise your hand if you're willing to give up 5%. Come on. Come on. Oh, okay. 2.199% of the Constitution. Let's raise your hand if you wouldn't give that up. At every debate, it was the same thing. Yet people still voted for David Perdue. They still voted for him. I know that hurts. It's called cognitive dissonance. You reveal to someone the truth, but it's just hard for them to grasp. They can't wrap their mind around the fact, I love all of the Constitution, I want all of the Constitution, yet this man would not say, I vow to obey 100% of the Constitution 100% of the time. And they still voted for him. I don't know how you can do it, because I can't. I had to stop, because I used to be a part of the problem. I'm no longer a part of the problem. I'm trying to be a part of the solution. My battle is not with those in D.C. My battle is for the hearts and minds of the people who continue to vote for those who don't care about the Constitution. I call it my guy syndrome. Well, my guy is okay. It's the other guy that's the problem. My guy is a good guy. My guy, he's a true leader. Let me tell you something. And I said this in the debates. And I got them all online. They got up in the first debate in Adale, Georgia, talking about, and I'll be the kind of leader that you can count on to go and do the job and get things done. And when they got around to me, I said, I don't know about the rest of you. I don't need a leader. I want representation. And I ain't been getting any. Not the kind of representation I want. Jesus is the only leader that I need in my personal life. I want somebody to go to D.C. that's going to represent the interests of his constituents and obey 100% of the Constitution 100% of the time. So if you need somebody to lead you, you keep voting for one of these clowns. But if you want a representative, then you need to vote for somebody that's going to represent your interests as an American citizen, as a citizen of the state of Georgia, and will obey the Constitution 100% of the time. And 100% of the Constitution. Now, I know your question is, what are we supposed to do? A lady asked me once, well, Derrick, you're taking this stance. How are you going to get anything done if you go to D.C.? This is where your my guys fail. First off, most of the my guys have no intentions of doing what they promise you in the first place. Oh, you need some examples. Let me give you one. Everybody I ran against said, I promise I'm going to go and repeal Obamacare. Gingrich even said, if we don't repeal Obamacare, I'm going to go home. David Perdue ran on, I'm going to repeal Obamacare. Now, Boehner and Reed and Rand Paul are already saying, we don't need to worry about trying to repeal Obamacare right now, because there's too much in it that people like, we need to fix it. And I have the debates where these people were talking about they were going to repeal Obamacare. Oh, you need something else. The Supreme Court Justice Scalia gave them a way to repeal Obamacare. When Obama was promoting Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, he said, it's not a tax, it's a mandate. You don't want to get an insurance, fine, you'll pay a small fine and that'll be the end of it. When they took it to the Supreme Court, Scalia came back and said, well, this is unconstitutional if you're calling this a mandate or a fine. It's unconstitutional for the government to force the American people to have to buy a commercial product if they don't want to, and penalize them for it. So what did Obama do? He reworded it, changed it from a mandate to a tax. And that's where Scalia gave us our out. Taxes can only be appropriated in the House of Representatives. This bill originated in the Senate. If they wanted to repeal Obamacare, they could have done so the very next day and made them start over from scratch, but they didn't. How many of your representatives, no, your leaders told you that? Ask them. When they were doing the so-called, we're gonna shut down the government if they don't defund Obamacare. And I said this on stage. That was nothing but smoke and mirrors. Obamacare, it was funded under mandatory spending, and because it was the law of the land, if they funded the government, they had to spend the money on it in the first. They couldn't defund it. But that ain't what they told you. These are the things that these people do in Washington, D.C. But we as voters don't pay attention to what they're doing, and we keep falling for the same okey-doke over and over and over again. Why? Because we want to believe them. And corporate-backed media is their greatest tool. I won in the last debate, and I'm going to tell you why I won in the last debate, in the race, in all the debates before that. I was told by the Republican Party that you can't run a statewide race. You have no name recognition. You have absolutely no money. I finished the race, and I won every debate. Don't tell me what I can't do. Now I know how they operate. I also know that the royals of both parties, there is no difference in the two. They are the same. They have the same agenda. They present you with controlled opposition to make you think that they are fighting for you when they are not fighting for you. Hank talks about the Fed all day long. But it is on the bottom, no, it's not even in their list. If we don't stop the Fed, there won't be anything left of this country. The dollar will collapse and we will be toast. You think the Depression was bad? But this is not on the minds of most of us because we can't see the bigger picture. We're focused on a single tree, my guy. Now I'm gonna deal with why your guy needs to go. If you were to ask me who is my hero in DC, I would tell you no one. There are 535 people up there, 100 senators, 435 representatives. And no, not a single one is my hero. They may be good guys, good women, but they are not my heroes. You want to know why? Because they are ineffective. Reality check. No matter who you have sent to D.C. in the last 20 years has made things better for this country. There's not a time in history, of recent history, where the deficit has started to go down or the budget was balanced or spending was cut. Things have gotten progressively worse. More conflicts, more dead soldiers, more debt, higher unemployment, fewer jobs. None of those things have gotten better in the last 20 years. Your my guy is ineffective, whether you like it or not. He's not getting the job done. Well, Derrick, what makes you think you're going to get the job done? Derrick is not going to get the job done. You are going to get the job done by sending Derrick to D.C. with a broom, a flashlight, and a whistle. See, most politicians go to D.C. and they operate in a vacuum. You remember that lie Obama talked about transparency? Look, we just now finding out the real deal from this knucklehead named Gruber about what they actually thought about the American people to get it passed. If you call that transparency, I need you to step from in the mirror because you're just really looking at yourself. Something that's transparent, you can see right through it. You can see all the insides. You ever seen one of those skeletons in high school where you see all the organs on it? That's transparency. We don't have that in D.C. And our my guy, those that suffer with my guy syndrome, thinking that their guy is doing the job when things are steadily getting better, the reason my guy ain't working is because my guy didn't go with two things, the Constitution and the people. You see, I'm going to tell you who's doing it to you. If I were in D.C., I would have told you, hey, folks, smoke and mirrors. They're not going to shut down the government. They'll make a few federal employees suffer. They'll still continue to get their paycheck. But, you know, the people that work in these what they call non-essential jobs, they won't get paid. We'll inconvenience their lives. And we're going to make you think that we're working to get rid of Obamacare for you. Okay? But that didn't happen. They still got paid. You still got searched at the airport. And they still warred over in Afghanistan. None of that stopped. The government still ran. But they made you think that there was a crisis. How many of you remember Ebola and ISIS? Ain't heard nothing about that since the elections happened. Manufactured distractions for the American people. Same thing with Ferguson. Manufactured distractions. Blacks have been getting killed by police officers. And so have whites. That ain't nothing new. But now it is a distraction to continue to keep you divided in voting for the same clowns that you keep re-electing. The worst approval rating in history, yet they enjoy a 90%+ re-election rate. Nothing is wrong with them. It's something wrong with us. Because we won't do something different. And the last thing I'm going to say, I get so sick of people blaming Obama when Bush was in office. That Bush. This is not the work of one man. There are 535 people in Washington, D.C. that make that one man possible. My guy syndrome at work. Well, Obama, we don't want you to bomb Syria because the American people have spoken and they don't want you to go over there. Oh, okay, well, the American people have spoken, I won't go over there. Aren't we bombing Syria right now? What happened to the American people didn't want us over in Syria? But we're bombing them anyway. Folks, stop falling for the okey-doke. You got to do something different. I was brave enough to get up and go and run to represent you. Be brave enough to send me. Stop re-electing these folk. David Perdue is not your friend. I was on stage with him. I talked to him. The man told me, Derrick, I don't want to interfere with Second Amendment rights. Then I heard the audio of him saying, well, I don't know if we ought to have campus care. Oh, wait a minute, man. You just said you wouldn't infringe on Second Amendment rights. You told me that. But then I hear it words out of your own mouth. Then I heard the man say, well, you know, you don't want handle. She only has a high school education. Well, how many of you in here, don't raise your hands, don't have more than a high school education? Don't raise your hand. You aren't qualified to go to D.C. Only David Perdue is. How many of you have not traveled the world? Don't raise your hands. You certainly aren't qualified because you don't have a worldview. These are the people that you vote for. These are the people you elect. And that won't change until you change. You have to do something different, else we'll keep getting what we've been getting. And with that, I'll shut up and answer any questions.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
You're absolutely correct. It's like the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. It doesn't happen. And Republicans definitely fall into that category. My question for you is about the black community. How can they be reached to see the destruction done to them by the people they vote for over and over and over again?
The black community at large or in whole, I'm not going to be able to reach you. They have been, we were talking about social conditioning and engineering. Prior to 1965, illegitimacy in the black community was less than 13%. Today it is greater than 70%. 7 out of 10 black babies born in this country are born out of wedlock. 500,000 black children are aborted every year. Blacks in urban prisons make up anywhere from 80 to 90% of the prison population. I can give you countless statistics about what's going on with the black community. That was a social experiment by liberal Democrat policies that succeeded. Now both the royals of Democrat and the Republican Party have gotten together and they are now doing it to the whole of America. Yes, that includes you, white people. You're on the list now. So I'm focusing on trying to reach the white community. Blacks that want to hear it, I'll tell them. But generally I'm met with name calling such as Uncle Tom, Coon, Sellout, et cetera, et cetera. It is what it is. I don't run from it, but that's just the reality of the world that we live in. So, did I reach you tonight? Did I reach you? Did I reach you? That's where my focus is tonight. Yes, sir.
When they were introducing you during the interview, I just have to remind you of something. About 7 or 8 years ago, there was a guy in this country that sold himself on change. For me and for you, don't say that you want to change America. That failed. Say you want to improve it or restore it. I'm saying that's a little bit of humor, okay?
Gotcha.
Don't say change.
Well, actually, I said I'm not going to change America. You have to. Let me be your arm.
Improve it. Restore it. Don't say change.
Gotcha.
I hope you don't say change.
No, I won't say change. Okay.
Derrick, if people are moved by your message, what can they do to support you, find out more about you? How can they hear more of your message, and what can they do to support you should you decide to be a candidate for the Senate?
Wake up your neighbor, your family members. Somebody told me that I should focus on a different strategy of trying to wake people up. And that is not trying to wake up the masses, but trying to wake up the lead sheep. The other sheep will follow the lead sheep. You don't necessarily have to get to the shepherd if you can just get to the lead sheep. Well, I need you to be lead sheep. I need you to tell people these truths. When you show them things that are verifiable and undeniable, these are things that they will have to sit down and reconcile in their minds. Some of them you will meet with cognitive dissonance. they won't be able to reconcile it. But that don't mean that you don't try. So number one, Hank, you need to do more than just show up to a meeting. You need to go and make converts, like when Jesus sent out the 70. And if they don't receive you, shake the dust and keep on moving. The second thing that you can do, if you want to know more about me, my platform, Team Grayson, we have a website, grayson2014.com. Soon it will be grayson2016.com. I put out YouTube videos. If you just Google my name, it'll get you to my channel, and you can listen. And if you are able to, donate. One of the things that I did not do in the last campaign was ask for money. And the reason I didn't ask for money in the last campaign, not at meetings that is because I did not think that it would be quite that necessary. But this time around, it is necessary, because now the people that I'm fighting is not those royals in the Republican Party or the ones that I may be running against. Our biggest adversary is corporate-backed media. The circle of loot is this. You have those at the top that own the corporations. The reason they bought up the corporations is so that the corporations could start buying up the media outlets. Well, why did the corporations start buying ownership of these media outlets? Because we had a president that was taken down by the free press. When I say the free press, unbiased press, that president's name was who?
Richard Nixon.
He was brought down by the free press. That press at that time was allowed to print the truth about the president, and it ended his administration, his candidacy. We no longer have that. So the circle of loot, they now control what you see in corporate-backed media. They also provide money to PACs and super PACs. The millions of dollars that are raised to get these guys elected doesn't come from individuals like us. It comes from corporations and businesses that have a vested interest in their servitude to them. So they give the money to the PACs and the super PACs. The PACs and the super PACs buy the advertising with the corporate-backed media outlets. And guess what? The same money that the owners authorize the corporations to give to the PACs and the super PACs, they spend it back with the corporate media outlets, and it goes right back to the owners. So they don't lose anything. And they donate to both candidates. Mitt Romney and Obama had the same donors. It didn't matter who won or who lost. You still lose. They win because they still get what they want. And if you look at the voting records of most candidates, you will see, yes, we have some controlled opposition, but bad legislation still continues to pass. I call that the circle of loot. And the only way to battle them is with money. Not money to run the kinds of ads that they run, because I will never engage in that. But money to enable us to reach a greater audience of people. Remember, the battle is not against the people that are in DC. The battle is for the hearts and minds of those who vote for them. We need to be able to reach them. So if you can donate, donate. I don't care if it's just $5. Every dollar helps.
Derrick, how do you get the half of the Republicans that were registered to vote who don't vote? That's always been amazing to me. You got all these registered Republicans who don't vote. And this happens every time.
The reason they're not voting is because nothing is getting better for them. I battle daily with people who tell me voting is a waste of time, so they don't vote.
You know, I've had someone tell me that the reason they didn't vote is because they didn't want to do jury duty.
Well, you know,
that's crazy.
You got something like that, but that's not the vast majority. Most folk don't care. Two things that have happened when people saw hope. The greatest number of young people went and registered to vote and voted when Ron Paul was running for president. And the greatest number of black people that have voted in probably 40 years went and registered to vote and voted when Obama ran the first time around. Why? Because they saw hope in those two individuals.
How did it look this time?
Well, if we continue to vote for the same kinds of candidates, we will continue to lose people who will not participate in the voting process because they won't see much difference. So you need something that's different. Wherever we went and spoke, I can't tell you the number of people that came up and said, you got my vote. I didn't know that about Kingston or Gingrich, but I'm voting for you now. That happened everywhere we went, because the singular most important thing that I got people to realize was the reason we're in the condition that we're in is because the people we continue to elect are violating the Constitution. There's a movement out now called an Article 5 Convention of States that they want to do. Article 5 was a provision put in by the Founding Fathers to allow us to fix defects in the Constitution. Did you hear what I said? To fix defects in the Constitution. Not to reinforce what they should already be doing in the first place. Why do we need a balanced budget amendment? We don't. We just need Congress to obey the Constitution. Then we wouldn't have spending on teaching Chinese prostitutes how to speak English. We wouldn't have all these various programs that we have. We wouldn't have a runaway deficit. We wouldn't have runaway spending and unlimited printing of the Fed. We have all those things because they are violating the Constitution. If we can't get them to violate the Constitution, and we have an Article 5 Convention of States, and they end up changing the Constitution that we do have, giving us something that we don't recognize, are you willing to run that risk? I'm not. Not on the basis of them saying they want to rein Congress in. We already have a document in place that should have that should be keeping Congress and the president and the judiciary reined in. And here's another truth. People don't understand this when I say it. I didn't believe in the civil rights legislation. Why did we need it? If they were obeying the Constitution that was already in place, the 14th Amendment had already fixed a defect in the Constitution, equal protection for all citizens, why did we need civil rights legislation? Because the Dixiecrats of the South found a way to circumvent the 14th Amendment with Jim Crow legislation that the Republicans after the Republicans of pre-Reconstruction were complicit in the Compromise of 1877. And that's where all that mess came up. We don't need an Article 5 convention. We just need to start voting for people that are going to show a fidelity to the Constitution. Catherine.
Derrick, I was wondering if you could talk about the event where you're going to be speaking on Saturday. I think you might be a little bit modest about your ability to reach people of all races, because I have seen you in front of these audiences, and the one on Saturday, I expect you will be picking up some new converts.
A gentleman by the name of David Hooks had his home raided 11 p.m. at night. A warrant signed on the word of a man who had just burglarized his home. Now that was a story that we were given. The police went to his home, cars screeching, no sirens, and they proceeded to go and kick the door in. The wife, Mrs. Hooks, is awakened. She warns her husband that the crooks are returning home. He grabs his weapon to defend his home, one of our constitutional protections, right to privacy, property rights. We even have a castle law here in Georgia. He was going to defend his home. He's not a crook. Man had contracts with a military base, been investigated by Homeland Security, GBI, FBI, background, two successful businesses, yet he was being raided in the middle of the night. And he was shot and killed by the police. 19 or so shots were fired. Now, you didn't hear about that because it doesn't fit the narrative of division. Well, why didn't you hear about that? Because then, particularly white America would know that it could happen to them too. You see, when I was running before, I would say to people, the attack on the Second Amendment is not to reduce crime. The attack on the Second Amendment is to disarm those who own most of the guns legally in this country, middle class white America. They want to know what you got, how much ammo you have, and what the capabilities of it are in addition to where you live. So when they come knocking, they don't want you to possess the ability to defend yourself against an unlawful search and seizure, or one where the warrant is questionable at best, and in this particular case, it was. See, Mr. Hooks is something that shows that the liberties and freedoms of this country are being eroded day by day. Obama said, all right, we're going to put cameras on the police. That is not to protect us. That's to give the federal government more reach into local police control. Everything that the government puts money towards, our taxpayer money, by the way, they end up controlling it. They're giving them tanks, flashbang grenades, bayonets, bulletproof vests, night goggles, masks, the whole nine yards. Now he's going to give them cameras, and he said, words out of his own mouth, I'm still going to let them keep their military hardware. They don't want white America hip to what's taking place under your noses. Because if you were to wake up and realize the slippery slope that we were headed down, you'd do something different. That's why I'm telling you. That's why I'm warning you. If they can do this to Mr. Hooks, a law-abiding citizen, they can do it to you. And they will. I keep telling you, 1,500 blacks killed by police, 2,500 whites killed by police. They aren't just killing black people. The police are killing white people. They follow orders. But none of that will change if we don't change the people who make the laws and the policies that the police are carrying out. That is on us. That's our job.
What can we do to, my main concern with the Constitution is getting the rights back to the states. And I think, just as an opinion, of states' rights could be an opportunity for the Republican Party to take back control of this country. I think now is the best opportunity for the Republican Party to change this direction. And I'm saying this as a general statement. I think the country, being 50 states, no one is more loyal to each state than that particular state. Say Georgia, for example. Nothing's better than a bulldog, okay? And by taking it in sections.
Yellow jacket.
Well, okay, that is, well, they lost too. I know, but you understand what I mean by breaking it in small bites. Because I like California, but I really love Georgia better. And what I'm saying is by taking it in small increments, and that's where we've really lost control of it. Because talking about D.C. to people in Georgia is like speaking German to someone in Georgia. But speaking Georgia to someone in Georgia is something that they can understand, a little bit more palatable. It's kind of a little closer to home. And I'm more concerned about the payment on the 400 than I am about the payment in D.C. or about the payment in Tennessee. And my You follow where I'm going?
Follow where you're going.
And what I'm saying by that is that what can we do? Because that's how it's supposed to have been. We've gotten so out of control and so focused on federal control of everything. We've lost total control of state control of everything. If I understand the Constitution, a little bit I know about it, it's supposed to have been controlled by the states. And the federal's supposed to be a little bit of things they're supposed to be doing. We, the states, are supposed to be doing the majority of everything. But we've totally lost control of it. And we should be controlling our kids and our schools and our education in the way we want it. And it gives you 49 other options. In other words, if you don't like the way it is in Georgia, you got 49 other options. So you can move to Colorado, or you can move to California, or you can move to Tennessee. But in Georgia, let the people in Georgia manage it and have it the way they want it in Georgia. And I think you can get people behind that, and they would support that. And we can get Republicans in Georgia to want it to be like it is in Georgia. I don't know if I'm making any sense or not. But
you are. Let me speak to something you just said. You mentioned control by the states, and one of those you brought was education. Raise your hands in your mind if you voted for Nathan Deal. Don't really raise your hand, so I don't want to embarrass you. Nathan Deal supports Common Core. But you were just talking about control of education. Well, how are you going to have control of education if the federal government is promising each state, if you implement Common Core, you're going to get X number of dollars from us?
That's my point.
Okay, well, so, but raise your hands if you voted for Nathan Deal. Okay, so my point is, anybody that voted for Nathan Deal, they're standing in your way.
I agree with you.
I didn't vote for Nathan Deal. I voted for the Libertarian. I am not bound to party royals. That's point number one. So you ask me, what could we do? We could stop being bound to party royals and start being bound to those that will support the Constitution. That is numero uno.
Yeah, but you've got to be able to get that voice loud enough, and it takes money, my friend, to hear you heard. Is that correct?
Tell your neighbors, your family, your friends. Go to my website, any other resources, read the little booklet that Ms. Tisdale has back there. Educate yourself and donate to the Grayson campaign. What else? What else you got?
No, I'm with you.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm with you. Hey,
I got,
we play ping pong all night.
I got an answer for you.
Okay, well, hey, I'm with you, man. Hey, I like it. You know, if I didn't, I'd tell you too. No, I'd like to see Georgia say, look, I don't want any of your money. I don't want any federal money. And tell the people in Georgia, say, look, this is how it is. It's going to be tough for a couple of years. We're going to have to kind of pave our own roads. We're going to have some holes in the road for a few years. But guess what? About 3-4 years, we can do the way we want to do. We can educate our kids the way we want them to be educated. And we don't have to put up with it. We don't have to put up with what they tell us to do. We can have our children educated the way we want them to be. We can have it the way that God wants it to be. We can have a constitution the way it's supposed to be. But as long as you take the money, the old saying, the man with the gold makes the rules, is the truth. As long as they have the gold and they send it down here, you have to do it the way they want it to be. And that's the problem we have. When you sit here and say, no, I don't want to do it. But if you want to get the money from the feds, you got to do it the way they want it done.
Well, let me lay the empty basket back at the feet of the people again. It is being put out that the people of the state of Georgia are sick of the federal government's interference, and they want a constitutional convention, an Article 5. That's a lie. Most people can't even define what an Article 5 is. It's not the people that push that. It is the legislators in the state of Georgia that push that for the purpose of making you think that they're fighting for you, when they're the ones who continue to take the money from the federal government in the first place, and they're going to go in there and strip away more of your rights without you knowing it, and before you know it, we got a new constitution where we have absolutely no rights already. They are already circumventing those rights. Two of your previous representatives, Kingston and Gingrey, voted to allow the government to spy on you, circumventing your Fourth Amendment protections. So if the Dixiecrats could circumvent the 14th Amendment with Jim Crow, and Kingston and Gingrey can circumvent the Fourth Amendment by voting for things like indefinite detention and the ability for the NSA to do warrantless wiretapping on American citizens, what makes you think that they will say, okay, well, Georgia, we want to do it ourselves? They won't. The only way to fix that is for you to change them. Now, let me clear something up for everybody. You see, we used to think that when we said the federal government and the state, that we were talking about the people of the state. You don't know it, but that has been changed. When they now say the state, they're talking about those knuckleheads that sit up under the Georgia Dome. They are talking about you. So when they're actually saying the state wants an Article 5 convention, it is not the people of the state of Georgia. Again, most of them don't even know what it is. And if you understand the dumbing down of America, our own Jimmy Carter gave us the Department of Education. My nephew graduated with honors and couldn't even score 650 on the SAT. Is something wrong with the education system or what?
When you're 47 out of 50, there ain't but three worse than you. I ain't real bright, but I can figure that out. There's only three worse than Georgia. So the system's not working.
Nope.
You can't argue 47 out of 50 is only three worse than you. So how well is it working?
It's not working, but it's not working because we keep doing the same thing over and over.
It's working as planned.
Yes, it is not working for us.
Yeah, I'm just saying if you cut all the federal law, I believe there's a lot of very smart, very intelligent people in Georgia.
Yes, it's but not. Listen.
I mean, all you got to do is turn it over to free enterprise. But free enterprise, that's what made America what it is. The problem is you got all these monkeys in all over these federal government people. You got state people just as stupid as they are. If you turn it over to free enterprise and let people get paid on commission based on how well they talk, and let the American people, let the Georgia people, educate the people and educate our kids, they'd be a lot smarter than they are now. I'll guarantee you, they couldn't be any dumber because there's only three states worse. You could turn them loose and let them be educated. I'll guarantee you, they'd be better than they are now. They couldn't do with three states worse.
We know how to fix the problem. It's not, that's not the issue. We know how to fix the problems. We know the answer to that. Obey the Constitution. But that's not going to happen if you keep electing people who will not obey the Constitution. Yes, sir, amen.
As long as there's a club in D.C. of 535 people that's paid differently, they don't have to go to work, they don't have to accomplish anything when they're at work, they don't have to worry about their health care system, we're always going to have people that want that job for self-aggrandizement, and that's it.
There you go.
And there's not anybody that's going to vote against that. There's not anybody that's going to attempt to change that.
There you go.
And it's not going to change until that happens.
Not going to change until you do something different. If you do something different, it will change. Yes, ma'am.
When you say that the royals, I would say, are in bed together, they're the same people.
Yep.
We need to realize that we, Republicans, Independents, Democrats, Libertarians, are not so different, too.
Not anymore to them.
Not anymore today. And what it amounts to, in my opinion, is it is them against the rest of us.
Absolutely.
And they're in charge, and until we figure out that I can sit next to a Democrat as a Republican and talk to them about an issue, and they think that we're horrible, and we think that they're horrible, it's the whole thing you're saying about the black-white issue with the thing. They have systematically divided this country while they're all the same.
There you go.
There you go, sums it right on up. 315 million people allow 536 people to tell them how to live and what to do.
Yep.
The government tells you, I'm going to create jobs. The government does not create jobs.
That's right.
The American people create the jobs.
There you go.
The people in D.C. are supposed to be serving us. Our police are supposed to protect and serve us. That has changed. But we are the ones responsible. Look, the hardest thing in the world to do is look in the mirror at yourself and own your own complicitness in corruption. Many of you want to be loyal to the party. We, those in the Tea Party movement, you're still Republicans, but you were so disenchanted with what was happening with your party that you got together as a group of people that you believe would be constitutionalists and do the right thing. I remember because I was supporting those Tea Party candidates wherever they were, think that they were going to go and do the right thing, and they got right up there and did what they said they wouldn't do. They compromised on a continuing resolution raising the debt ceiling. Yeah, that's an ugly truth that many of us don't want to acknowledge. But until you are willing to look in the mirror and own your own complicitness and vow to do something different by not voting for the same people again, the same kinds of people, certainly not re-electing those that have already been in the room, none of this will change. It will only get worse. Neil?
Well, you spoke to the Nathan Deal level. But people need to know that that same standard has to go all the way down to the lowest elected position in the country. The trouble is that so many people that I talk to, I say something about, well, who did you vote for the insurance commissioner? Most of them look at me and say, what is the insurance commissioner? If you ask them about the agriculture commissioner, they don't even know what an agriculture commissioner does. Same thing with Secretary of State. Our Secretary of State was promised during his campaign to change the ballots, to have the ballot machines, to have an audit trail. He went in, it's been 4 years, he didn't do it. He's in now and he's still not going to do it. I mean, that's the people you're talking about, we got to change. But we have to do it. We have to know what those people are. We have to know not only what their character is, but what they stand for when we elect them. Because remember, we grow that bunch in Washington from down here. They start out at the lowest levels. And by the time they get through the seats and up their way, guess what? They're just like the ones that are up there now.
And it rolls down here, and I'm gonna get over here. I saw a question from Hank. I'll get to you in just a second. Ms. Tisdale, I don't know if any of you know her or not. Now, regardless of whether you know her or not, I need you to step inside the psyche of what's happening with the Royals. At an event where she was videotaping, she was ejected and arrested for videotaping. And Nathan Deal sat in the front row and didn't say a word. See, that is disturbing to me, that a man who would not want the public to know what it is that they're doing. How can you say you're mad with Obama about transparency, but get mad because she shows up to record what you are saying? You can't have it both ways. The character that you see in your representatives is what you're going to get in your legislation. Hey,
are you available to speak to other groups, church groups, political groups, Rotary clubs, and how do people get in contact?
Talk to us later, Hank.
Jason Turner, I'm on Facebook. If you want to find me, you can. But I will go anywhere and everywhere to speak to anybody that will hear me, even if I don't win the Senate race. It is in my best interest to get you not to do what you have been doing, because it affects my future too and the future of my children.
I want you to do something different.
Thank you for your comment, Mr. Grayson. I was wondering, on a personal note, what got you politically active and what was a catalyst for you to run for office? And I respect those who have the courage to run for office.
I got involved in the political process in 2011 because I said just voting is not enough. I started out by campaigning for Ron Paul, and I'll tell you what led me to that. In George Bush's second term, when he brought us TARP, I lost it. I didn't know what else to do. TARP, the biggest corporate welfare program in history. I didn't recognize the Republican Party. Then Obama ran and sold me on change. And I voted for him in his first term. And 18 months after he was in office, he was doing the exact same things that George Bush was doing. That's when I knew both parties, the royals, were the same. There was no difference in them. And a friend of mine turned me on to Ron Paul. And I started campaigning for Ron Paul. And what made me decide to run, I was at the RNC in Tampa. And to prevent Ron Paul from being nominated from the floor, they changed the rules on the plurality of states from 5 to 8, which prevented him from being nominated on the floor. Now, whether you like Ron Paul or not is really irrelevant. When you deprive the people of their right to choose with disinformation and underhanded shenanigans, you do a disservice to all voters. You should know what is available to you. And with that, I said, I can no longer abide the corruption of either party. Now, I will die a Republican. I am not leaving the Republican Party, and I'm not trying to destroy the Republican Party. But I'll be damned and go to hell before I continue to sit back and let the royals destroy the Republican Party that was responsible for the emancipation of the slaves and the 14th Amendment. I won't do it. I will fight you if you're in this room.
Outstanding. Thank you so much for that. It's outstanding. Really do appreciate you coming out tonight. That was outstanding. Very eye-opening and very refreshing. One of the best speakers, if not the best, I've had for many months. Well, thank you for coming out tonight, and we hope you want a Merry Christmas to you, to each of you, and good night. Thank you.
Thank you.